You're listening to music from the Academy Award winning Up, Michal Giacchino, the composer. It's Air Talk on KPCC. I'm Larry Mantle. And for the next hour, we're going to focus on film composition, the power of music in movies. And in addition to Michal Giacchino, we have Randy Newman, David Newman, and Trevor Rabin. I'll give them more in-depth introductions as we continue from the Crawford Family Forum. We're all familiar with the power of great movies, but we don't often consider what they be like without their scores. This scene from Rennie Harlan's 5 Days of War makes the point. The film chronicles the 2008 South Ossetia War over a Russian-backed breakaway region in Georgia. First, we see the scene with an unaccompanied Georgian president, Mikhail Saakashvili, played by Andy Garcia.
Standing with us here tonight are six European presidents who have traveled thousands of miles in defiance of fear and threats. These six men are here because they know the issue of independence is being...
Strong performance. You get the emotion of what's going on in the moment. But then with Trevor Rabin's original music that accompanies this scene, you get a sense of how much more powerful it can be with music.
Or not.
Standing with us here tonight, European presidents who have traveled thousands of miles in defiance of fear and threats. These six men are here because they know the issue of independence is being decided here tonight. May God bless the Georgian people and long live a free Georgia.
Tone is going to be how you're going to underscore the action.
It wasn't a difficult one, this, because it was pretty clear what had to happen, and particularly when he raises up his hands, the big surge and the big melody come in. So it wasn't a difficult
one. Almost like he was conducting you, and where, exactly. Where the music is to come in. But a lot of films are much more challenging than this
in
determining what tone the director's wanting to hit.
Right, especially when the studio might say to you, there's no emotion, and the lead actor's been miscast. Can you fix him?
So, Michal Giacchino, you have much experience with that, being asked to fix something?
You know what? I haven't. I work very insular groups of people. I work with my friends. The people that I've been working with, I've been working with for many years. And
you got directors as friends, do you?
I do. I do, actually.
They come over to your house?
They do. They come to my house.
All right.
Yes, they do. And I know it sounds odd, but I mean, once I kind of got those people, I kind of just only work with them. You know, I mean, you just want to, you know what that's like.
Can I say something about that?
No. Yeah, David, yes, David, yeah.
No, I don't.
I absolutely don't. You know what I think is interesting about that is you watch the scene without any music, and it seems very energetic and heroic, but you put music on it, and you feel this anguished past history of a, maybe I'm overstating it a little bit, but you feel something completely different when you put the music. Yeah, it gets big and it's heroic, but it adds something that's not there that you cannot do visually or with a script or narratively.
Trevor,
so I've
been tipping you for that comment. But
I
think you're really onto something just as a viewer, because you get a sense of history there with the music that takes you not just, you know, with that scene, but takes you beyond it to something bigger. That's a very powerful experience. Yeah. Randy Newman, you'll speak to that. Because you work with some very strong emotions in the Pixar films that you've written music for, and you leave them without a dry eye in the house in some cases. So how are you underscoring some of the emotions the film raises?
Well, the thing about the Pixar movies, which isn't always evident, is that they're always dealing with adult emotions. They take them very seriously. no matter how much comedy there is in the pictures, the central aspect of them is the emotional content. So they take them seriously, and so do I, and you try and make it count.
Can you give us an example of one of the songs you wrote for one of the Pixar films and how the composition process unfolded?
Well, I can tell you, I wrote a song for when Buzz, in the first picture, Buzz Lightyear, the spaceman, jumps off a balcony and falls for 2 minutes and 48 seconds, which I had to play. the first, I wrote a song which was thrown out, and I had a little comedic aspect to it. It was about he discovered that he was not a toy. And I had a little thing that was made in Taiwan, this little amusing thing I thought was amusing. And the people at Pixar didn't think it was particularly amusing. And as much as it galls me to say it, I think they were right. And they wanted something that was just heartfelt, which pushed me into some strained ranges, you know, having, oh, no, it can't be true. I'm afraid of my enemies. It was, you know, which is amusing in itself. So I wrote as straight as you can be about a goddamn spaceman, you know, who doesn't spaceman toy who thinks he's not a toy.
They have emotions too.
So. Yeah, they have emotions too, and you take it seriously, and I did, and so did everyone else.
Randy Newman with us on Air Talk. You come from a family of composers. Even your dad wrote, right? He was a doctor, but he also
wrote
songs.
Who gave you the roses on your wedding night? Who do you suppose is glad you're happy? And then I blew it. I blew the lyric.
I haven't heard that in a long time.
He's down there watching us, too.
You have three uncles who are giants
David's father. Yeah.
Father and his two uncles as well. So, I mean, it's kind of the family business. But did you ever think about writing for films early on or not?
It looked very difficult. I mean, they were moaning about it quite a bit. I mean, when you're a little boy, and your uncle, David's father, asks you, you know, what do you think of this? And you know, I don't know what I thought of it. And they says, is this, you know, you could tell he was worried. It may have had a bad effect on me, you know. I mean, I don't think so. I mean, intellectually, I realize it's not the most important job in the world. You know, it's not as important as the dialogue or who the lead actor is or who's holding the camera or what they're pointing at or what they're wearing or a lot of different things. But to me, it's often been life and death, you know, and maybe to some of the other guys, too. But it may have had a deleterious effect.
David, what about for you? I mean, was it intimidating? Your father, such a giant of film, Anthony Newman, and then your uncles,
Alfred,
and then Lionel and Emil, your uncles, with their huge success. Was that intimidating?
It wasn't, I think, so much for us. We were a little bit younger and didn't have so, like Randy was around a lot and saw a lot of them working. We saw a little bit of it, but I think for me and probably for Randy, the most important thing in the movie is the music, I would say. So that's how our family views it.
But
of course.
Getting into a trumpet solo while someone's talking,
right,
you're going to be out of a job.
Right. So, but you still know it's the most important, even if the director doesn't,
It's obviously not the most important. The most important thing is the movie, this thing. It's more important than the actor, the director, than anybody. You know, you start writing music for a movie, and we all say that cue works or it doesn't work.
Right.
And it either works for this thing that's the movie, that's the sum of all these different people, or it doesn't work. And you can go back and analyze why it doesn't or blah, 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 but still it either works or it doesn't. It's
absolutely
a very odd thing.
We're going to continue with our four film composers on this special edition of Air Talk from the Crawford Family Forum. With me, David Newman, from whom we just heard, his cousin Randy Newman, Michal Giacchino, and Trevor Rabin are with us here on 89.3 KPECC. Coming up, we're going to be talking more about the challenges of the business, how it's evolved over the years, how someone who really loves film music and wants to get into the industry can figure out a way inside without being a Newman. We'll talk about that as we continue. Continue on Air Talk on 89.3 KPECC. Now time for a news update. Air Talk guest David Newman's composition, Dodos, that's from Ice Age. One of the examples we're sharing with you as we come your way from the Crawford Family Forum. Four great film composers talking about their work and the challenges that their business is experiencing with ever tighter budgets and ever tighter time deadlines as well. Joining us is Trevor Rabin, David Newman, Randy Newman, and Michal Giacchino. Our Film Week critic Wade Major asks, which film composers do each of you particularly love? Michal Giacchino, is there someone you point to you think is the pinnacle of the form?
Obviously, John Williams is amazing, right? I mean, come on. He's like one of the greatest there ever was or will be, I think. But I'm a huge Max Steiner fan as well. Huge Max Steiner. I love, but it goes beyond film music. I love guys like Benny Goodman and Louis Prima and composers like that. I don't know. I love all kinds of music. For me, I could listen to polka music and be perfectly happy.
So you just grew up as a music lover?
Yeah, totally. My dad had the craziest music collection of all kinds of things, from Broadway musicals to, like I said, the 1940s jazz, 30s jazz, all the way up to, and then my sister's crazy tastes in all kinds of rock and roll, including the music of that gentleman down there on the end.
Multiple influences,
yes.
Here. Randy Newman, for you, your biggest influence, person you most look up to as a composer?
Well, my Uncle Alfred, I think, is not the best, one of the best. Well, about the best. Johnny Williams, certainly, and Jerry Goldsmith. Prokofiev was very good when he did it.
Yeah, a little bit of talent. David.
Yeah, but doesn't mean, you know, what David was saying is so true. You could be Prokofiev or Shostakovich or Copland. I was looking at a picture once and I thought, you know, this sounds like someone imitating Copland, but it's bad Copland. And it was Copland. In any case, that's some of them.
So what do you suspect happened? A guy with that much talent?
His first picture or you know, something.
And he
else,
didn't understand the form?
I don't know. Maybe. I can't remember what picture it was. It might have been of Mice and Men.
Or the Red Pony.
It was
maybe.
Early. No, that was good, Red Pony.
So
by that time, he was...
Well, you can always blame it on the director, right? So that's...
Well, no, not this one. It was, you know, he was out there.
You never know, though. I mean, you know, you don't know. I mean,
no,
times,
you don't know,
because you're writing. Sometimes when, like, a guy like him, he's writing freely. He's able to write what he wants normally. Then suddenly he's kind of handcuffed to this thing in front of him. So it might just create a different process for him. Who knows?
If it doesn't fit, it doesn't matter if it's Beethoven. You know. Beethoven's in plenty of pictures where it doesn't fit.
Yeah, very true. David, your pick. Maybe you want to leave your dad out so that.
Well, my dad, present company accepted, but my dad is a huge influence for me for a lot of reasons, not just the composing, but the administration and the running of a music department. And you're talking about Max Steiner and the way these guys ran these music departments. They were filled with string players from Europe that were running away from that horrible, you know, the horrible situation in Europe. I think... It's in a really an amazing city, and it's an amazing thing that happened in the 30s, 40s, and 50s. So I still think, to me, Alfred Newman, Jerry Goldsmith, I think I've had the opportunity to conduct a lot of his music and actually really look at the orchestration, the music, which is where you really learn about a person, a composer, by looking at their notes and what they do. I don't know. I learned a lot about my father by looking at music. So,
and you're big on film preservation. You've done a lot of work on it. It's been a priority of yours. Is that at least in part because you feel like some of it is family legacy?
I think some of it, but I also think there's a great deal of great concert music involved in these thousands of films and film scores, and it's a travesty that you cannot have the parts and scores, which are the blueprints that you need for an orchestra to play it. I find it's a real blight on the industry. Maybe it's some of our fault that are in film music, but I think overall this stuff should be available to be studied at least, and better yet, performed as concert music, because a lot of it works great as concert music, and people all over the world are really interested in this kind of music.
Well, and we've been music, fortunate sure, here, because the Hollywood Bowl's been a place where some of this has been performed. Yeah. Trevor, let me ask you another question, because this is actually targeted to you from Julie in San Diego, who asks, she said, you stated previously you believe there's a trend regarding the amount of score that contemporary film contains, yet also noting you think it's a bad idea to call attention to it because it might hurt you professionally if you do that. Is it difficult to attempt to convince directors, producers to consider restraint in the writing of scores while still doing your best to satisfy their demands?
It's probably not a good idea, but I do it so anyway. Because, I mean, too much music eventually becomes wallpaper. Yeah. And it doesn't help the film a lot of the time. And
why then do we see the other so much? Because to me, I feel as a viewer, it insults me. Because it's as though the music has to point me to every point in the film where I'm supposed to have an emotional reaction or supposed to know what's going on, as though I can't figure it out.
I think a lot of times it's because people don't believe enough in the film. And they think they need the crutch of music to play every single part.
And they're used to the temp music track. They have
the temp music track?
Called temp music, which is... They've looked at it for 2 years with a temp music track, and when it's not there, it makes them nervous, I think. I'm not on mic?
Yeah, now you are.
Do they miss everything I said?
But once you perform for a little bit, you'll get real used
to it. Yeah, I'll get used to this. So it becomes a bit of a crutch. Right?
Yeah, and so tell us a little bit, for those of us who aren't familiar with temp tracks, Michal, do you want to share what that's about?
Yeah, basically, when you get a cut of the film, it will have temporary music. So they might grab music from any other film. It could have the music of, you know, who knows what in there from any time. They just grab a CD, put it in there. Because they're just trying to see if it's working. What they're making, they're trying to see if it's working. And it's more for an internal use, or if they need to show studio executives, here's our movie and here's how it's going to work emotionally. I get it, and you can turn it off, which is really nice. And I generally will just turn it off and try not to listen to it unless one of the directors says, you know, just listen to that just for the tone. And again, I have to say I'm really super lucky to work with people who will be the first to say, you know, don't even listen to that.
Who's doing the temp track?
Well, it's usually the director and the editor working together to do it. And it depends on the director you're working with. Certain directors I work with are very into making sure that temp track works great. Other ones are... leave that to the editor to do.
So they fall in love with it and then want that duplicated
sometimes
with original music.
It can happen that way. Yeah, it can definitely happen that way. I haven't run into too much of that.
Because of your partnerships with the directors.
We have a great relationship. But there is, like I said, on occasion, they might say, just listen to it for this detail or for that. They're very particular about it. But it can go the opposite direction where they completely handcuff you to it.
Glenn in Pasadena asks, could you describe how you prefer working with a director? At what stage you prefer coming on board? David, do you want to take that?
Yeah, well, you'd prefer coming on board as soon as possible. The sooner, the better. The more you can be at the script stage and shooting and all that, the better. The more time you have to write, the better. The more, the better.
Does that happen for you very often, in early?
Not really, but sometimes. I think all of us have probably had the experience of having plenty of time and then not having plenty of time.
Randy,
but we all tend to sort of like whine about it, too. So, I mean, this is just the way it is. It's a fantastic job, And there are some things with temp music, and all of us have had wildly different experiences of horrible temp. You know, I'm sure I've had some horrible temp trap experiences, but you know, it's just the way
that
it
just
is
what comes with it. Yeah. Randy, are you typically in on the Pixar films very early in the process?
Relatively early, because that's how they work it. You know, you see little stick drawings, and you see it fairly early, and you get versions of it that are timed correctly. I don't know whether this is the same with you, but I assume so, Michal.
Yeah.
That are timed correctly so you can do the music, but aren't necessarily the finished picture. So you're in it a bit early. It's hard, I find it difficult, unless you see the picture, to write music that's going to work. So
storyboards just can't convey it in the same way.
I don't want to be in there too early necessarily, you know?
Okay. And Michal, you're there pretty early on with the directors that you work with repeat basis.
I'm in there early because I'm just fascinated by the process. I will go, like J.J. Abrams is in the middle of shooting the new Star Trek film right now, and I've been having such a great time just going and visiting. When I have the chance, go down, stay with him, watch him shoot. And
you're a well-adjusted son of a bitch. You know, holy shit. I mean, I wouldn't go to a set if I fell on it. If it were in my backyard, I wouldn't go.
I'm going to ask him.
And that doesn't make me hip. It makes me, like, sick.
I got to ask you something, because this is going to sound strange, but one of my favorite movies is a movie called The Three Amigos.
Yeah.
All right? Now, I watched it with my kids recently, and they absolutely loved it. But I never realized how much you actually had to do with that film, other than just writing the music and the
songs.
I wrote
the songs.
But you didn't have something to do
script.
With the script, right?
Yeah.
And you were the singing bush.
I was the singing bush, yeah.
Come on!
Not the burning bush, but the singing bush.
Oh, now you're just trying to get on my good side by praising my acting. It was a real irritable bush, too. Out in the sun, 15 miles on the Erie Canal.
I was listening to it, and I'm thinking, oh, my God, that's Randy singing that. So I, you know, went to the credits, and there
that was fun. No eighth notes, you know, no
Can you tell us anything
rest.
About that?
It was Lorne Michaels, Steve, and I, and we'd meet every day and try and be funny from 2 to 5. And Steve was in charge of the word processor. And there was a scene in which, this is the only anecdote I remember, where a bell rung and it reverberated through the village. And I said, you know, the bell rung, and we were trying to think of what the, you know, how to say it, that this bell rang. And Steve said, okay, the bell tolled a loud ding, he said. And I said, well, you can't have that. You can't have a toll, a loud ding. There's something wrong with it. He says, it's a goddamn script. So any time the bell rung, he had the word processor, and he put it in the script, and any time the bell rung, it tolled a loud ding. That's it. I don't have an ending for it, but I've never told it before. That's all I remember about it.
Film composers Randy Newman, David Newman, Trevor Rabin, and Michal Giacchino with us. It's Air Talk, a broadcast from the Crawford Family Forum. Great to have you with us as we talk about the art of scoring for film. Another question coming from Mary in Glendale. It was announced that Jack White of the White Stripes is going to compose the music for The Lone Ranger with Johnny Depp. There are a lot of notable crossover artists, started with a popular music career.
Is it all going to be an A minor?
Hmm? Yeah.
Is it all going to be an A minor? Oh.
Good question.
Okay.
Randy Newman, you did this. Trevor Rabin, you did this, beginning in the world of popular music, moving into film. So, I mean, I assume you two guys think this is a fine trend. Is that right?
Well, the way I came in was very different. I didn't come in with somebody to do it. I actually got a film, and I think the trend of the Nine Inch Nails and the Jack Whites are basically rock musicians teaming up with a film composer and mucking around.
So how do you feel about it? Do you think that advances the art form potentially?
You never know. One never knows. Does one?
One doesn't.
Yeah.
We'll have to wait and see.
It's a big philosophical discussion issue that's hard to talk about, because the act of composing is not, in my view, is not really an act that requires all that much training. You're either a composer or you're not, devoid of what you've done or how you actually do it. But there has to be somebody along the line to score a movie that has training, just because there's so many people involved that need certain things that take a certain amount of training to do.
But that's not
what the actual impetus of composing is. Composing is different than the technical way of getting it to the market, you know.
So someone who's good at what you do has to be able to do both. And I'm assuming they don't?
No, because that's what Randy's saying.
Oh, you hire someone to do the tech part of it.
Well, I'm hesitant to call it technical, because what we're talking about, I think, is orchestration and copying and all of these things, which are hardly technical. There's a huge art involved in what that is as well. So,
but separate than what
we call
it's
a completely
composing.
Different discipline than what you would say if someone was just composing a score. Yeah. I guess in the way we're talking about.
There's still enormous snobbery in music in every way. Snobbery in rock and roll about what is rock and roll. This is rock. This isn't. You know, it's nonsense. Classical musicians about film music and about everything else in the world.
I sense a song coming
in film music. The snobbery was the people they called hummers. You know, who don't write it down and were just not humming, but it was just. And now there are people who don't write anything down necessarily, but play it. But what David is saying is that that's another way of composing, that's all. It's not, there's nothing less about it than if you do what John Williams does, or if you write it all down as some do.
Well, what are your feelings about large orchestrated scores versus non-traditional kinds of instruments, unusual sound? Do you feel like, you know, the more the merrier, that if it works, it works, doesn't matter what
you're
trying?
If it works, it works.
Yeah, it's got to fit the film, right? It's got, you're making something that needs to fit a film, a story, a particular event that's unfolding in front of you. So it may call for a big orchestra, it may call for one player.
Well, I was thinking of like Johnny Greenwood's score for There Will Be Blood, which was so polarized audiences, people loved it or hate it. I mean, that to me seemed a risk-taking score for that film.
Yeah.
What did you think of it?
I thought it was all right.
That doesn't sound polarizing.
That's the one that had the Brahms Violin Concerto at the end.
Right.
Right,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to continue.
I didn't like it because I was hoping to do the film.
And it was judged harshly. We'll continue from the Crawford Family Forum. It's Air Talk. Four top film composers joining us on Air Talk. We're so pleased to have with us Michal Giacchino, Randy Newman, David Newman, and Trevor Rabin. More conversation to come, but first a chance to update ourselves on the news.
The music in a film.
It's Air Talk from the Crawford Family Forum. I'm Larry Mantle. As you listen to Trevor Rabin's score for The Sorcerer's Apprentice, it's a chance to bring together four top film composers to talk about the art form that obviously they've dedicated many years to, and to talk about the challenge of taking a film, trying to enhance what's there on the screen through their compositional skills. Very pleased to have with us David Newman, Michal Giacchino, Trevor Rabin, and Randy Newman, all joining us. I have a question that comes from Taylor in Laguna Niguel. Michal, this is for you. Taylor says he's been a fan of your work since the Medal of Honor video games, and so wonders, you know, could you ever see yourself doing a video game again? Didn't you do one a year or so ago?
A few years ago, I did a Medal of Honor game, actually. When a friend of mine who was producing it came back to do a new version of it, he asked what. So I went and did it with him because I had worked on the original ones.
So how different is it? Because, I mean, the person playing the game creates what happens in the game.
You know, it's very different now. When I was doing it back then, I was just writing music based on these story structures that I kind of created in my head based on how the game was unfolding. Now, these guys are writing music that needs to change and turn on a dime and do everything based on, you know, now with technology, as you said, I've become kind of ignorant as to what is going on in that world. And honestly, a lot of the people that I worked with that time don't do it anymore, so I just kind of moved on to different things.
Okay, all right.
Don't you get an orchestra, though?
Yeah, we had orchestras for those, but I got to be honest, I would not have had an orchestra if it wasn't for Steven Spielberg, because that game, the first game I ever did, the Lost World video game, was supposed to be an all-synth score. So he heard the mock-ups for it, and he just said, "So when are we recording this with the orchestra?" And of course, the guys at the interactive company were like, "What?" You know, they didn't want to pay for that.
Oh, the orchestra,
yeah.
Right?
But because he said it, they were like saying, "Well, Michael's putting together a budget for that right now, aren't you, Michael?" I was like, "Yes, I am," and that's really what kicked it off. But you need someone at the top who actually believes in orchestra and believes in what a live musician can bring to the table, because I think without them, without the musicians, which we haven't spoken enough about tonight, without the musicians, we would have nothing. And it's their emotion, it's their talent, and their art that it gets poured into all this. So.
And you work with the same musicians
over and over.
All your projects.
Yes, yes.
So you really develop the team ethos.
It's really a family. We have a family, and we have a lot of fun doing it. Yep.
So who are some of the important parts of that, the technical people that you rely on as well? What are the roles
they
fulfill?
We all have relationships with particular recording engineers. I work with a guy named Dan Wallen, who is he's 85 years old and has recorded, 500 movies, and it's incredible. And he could still beat me up at that age. And I'm sure everyone else has their own, if you guys want to.
So you each have kind of trusted teams that you work with? So people that you're able to really figure out what they do best and work with that.
You want a shorthand. It's important, don't you think?
Yeah, I work with different engineers, but good ones, and they bring an enormous amount to whatever you do. As does what studio you're in,
I want to ask about women in the profession, because being all guys, I don't see a lot of credits for women who are film composers. And any of you have a theory as to why that is?
They're not as good.
I would say they're smarter than us to get into something like this.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, is it something where there are barriers to women having opportunity to it?
Well, there have been for like 5,000 years, there have been barriers. And they're, I would think they're being broken down, but it's a slow process. I'm working on it all the time.
Really?
There's some wonderful players in the orchestra.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, there's a lot of women in the orchestras.
Yeah, there's a lot of women in the orchestras.
A lot of women musicians, yeah.
There was just an article about gender and sexism and kind of tacit racism in Hollywood. I mean, Hollywood isn't the most diverse population. Forget the film stuff. Just in general, television and
Australia.
Film. It's not. Yeah. So.
Randy, you've won Oscars for original songs for films, and it seems that the idea of a film having a song with which it's associated has become less and less common. And first, I don't know if you agree with that. Generally, is a trend in the industry, but
it's like having malaria. The Academy treats songs, but they could only find two songs last year that got 8 points or something, or whatever it was.
So, to what do you attribute the less interest?
It's always like they put them in a medley. They question the entertainment value of the songs. Like the entertainment. What about the entertainment value of the show? There's a reason vaudeville died.
Oh, you're talking about the Academy Awards show. Yeah, about the show itself.
But generally
songs,
in the industry.
Songs, if music is subordinate to the movie and everything, songs are subordinate to everything. I mean, there have been egregious sort of things like tagging a song on the end of a movie and things like that and other things I've done.
Mr. Egregious.
Sometimes they're significant, and most often they're not. of the ones I've done, a couple of them have been sort of important to the picture, you know.
Jared asks, when you're composing for a particularly sad, a poignant scene in a film, do you feel the emotion as you're writing it, or is it professionalized, or are you distant
from
it?
When I'm writing music for a happy thing, I feel sad.
You're just a contrarian. Yeah.
No, you feel it. Yes, yeah. You do. Or you maybe you don't do it as well. I mean, you know.
You all agree with that.
You have to know what you're trying to do, yes.
Yeah. I mean, for me, I have to feel it or it's very hard to write.
Very
hard to manufacture emotion, but it's much easier to work on something that you actually feel something when you watch it. I remember even the first time I watched Up, that sequence there, the married life sequence, I remember I cried and that was just storyboards, you know? It was just, you're watching this thing and you're just like, oh my God, that's gonna happen to all of us.
Yeah.
You know, it's something I think you have to feel and want to feel.
I want to ask you about that because it was a scene, as you say, and I understand why the storyboards were loaded with emotion, but it could have so easily tipped, and you were able to just walk that line, and your music played an important role in that. So how are you able to bring the sentiment that's legitimate that the scene calls for without it tipping into sentimentality?
Well, a scene is a story, you know, and you need to tell a story. You're not just writing one piece of music that is saying one thing. You're writing a piece of music that is saying multiple things at multiple times. And it's about kind of creating the architecture for that story. And luckily, I mean, we work with great storytellers, so some of that work is already done with the film that they give you. And that structure is laid out for you. And so it's about identifying that structure and following it and essentially holding its hand with music and following along with it and not deviating from it. That's my experience with it, anyways.
You know, one thought
Trevor?
I had was when I found it quite easy to write the emotional side to a film called Remember the Titans. And I realized afterwards, Denzel Washington is just a fantastic actor, and that doesn't hurt,
yeah.
You know.
So you
it
were
might
able
be a little
tap.
More difficult with Claude Van Damme. I don't know. You know?
Speaking of which, have any of you had a film that you didn't get it, you didn't like it, the film didn't speak to you, but you needed to do it as work? And how did you deal with that?
Neither of us can mention which ones those are.
I understand you can't mention, but has it happened?
Yeah. You forget you don't like it.
I think you start. You watch it over and over and over and over, and you start to bond toward it.
Right.
You know. I mean, there. Let's face it. There are less great movies than there are mediocre movies. So you can't spend your whole life doing just great movies if you're going to have a career of over, you know, 30, 40 years or whatever. So I think you tend. I would guess that most everyone tends to bond to it because you can't do it unless you bond to it. It's also what makes it kind of painful if somebody doesn't like something because you put so much of yourself into it. But if you don't put yourself into it, there's no point in doing it. It doesn't, you know, quote unquote work.
It does hurt, you know. You know, the good natured things I say about directors. When you may think they're stupid about music and they don't know. You can't. I always tell kid students of music and film music because you can't take someone else's valuation of you as a true valuation. But when a director, even when you don't necessarily respect, likes something you do, you become this servile little puppy dog, you know, because the way things are now with the power that directors have, you're writing for one person sometimes, you know, and if he's okay with it. You're okay with it. You know, all of the trepidations you may have and the worries you may have about the tempo and the mood and whether it should be an oboe or a clarinet.
That's
you know, the guy
be,
likes it. It's out the way.
That's got to be
know.
Hard, though, because
yeah,
in an
hard.
Ideal world, you're writing for the audience. You're not writing
well,
for
you're
the
writing
director.
For the audience. You're writing for yourself first.
Yeah,
it's got to get by you
first.
But then it's got to get by the director. And you sometimes you have to do things to get it by him.
We've had a lot of questions about how to get started in the business. People that love music, love films, want to get into it. Trevor, you want to start us on how, what advice you give to young people starting out?
Well, a lot of people who I've come across that are very talented and very good at what they do, haven't really got into the dynamics of the politics involved and how often you come up with a director who's not necessarily seeing things the same as a producer and how to determine which one to listen to, and those are very difficult. And even as simple as being able to call an agent, those kind of things seem, as far as the curriculum, if you like, for learning this stuff seems to be a secondary consideration.
So it's really navigating the relationships, and I would assume building the relationships too, because probably each of you have relationships professionally that have been very helpful to getting work, that's a big part of this.
Right.
So if someone doesn't have that skill set, it sounds like it's going to be a very difficult business.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
It has been.
David, you have any advice on this?
I think it's much harder now than it used to be. There are so many film music schools and so many people doing film scores now. So I don't know. I think it's like it's learning everything that Trevor was saying and really not giving up. I mean, if you really want to do it, you just have to barrel down and figure it out and never give up.
Now, I understand some composers use ghostwriters. And so if someone is starting out in the business and that's what they can get, jobs doing that, do you advise doing that or not? What do you think?
That's up to the individual, really. I mean, they have to kind of look at what they're prepared to do in that respect. For me, that would be very difficult. I wouldn't want to do that, but other people are perfectly fine and happy doing that. So, I mean, it's a really individual taste.
So is it a different thing? If you've got a composer who that's kind of part of his process, he hires people to write for him, and he's sort of more like the head coach,
right,
than writing all the stuff, do you see that as just another way of accomplishing the same thing, or is there a downside to farming out some of the writing?
It depends on how you look at what you do. If you're looking at what you're doing as just a business, then yeah, it's fine. If you look at it as, no, this is an art form that I want to participate in, I want to create something, then it's not so good, you know? Film composing can be a business or it can be an art. And sometimes you may luck out and get both when you do it that way, but it's not always in your control.
Anybody else with a thought on that?
It's hard to tell a kid what to do in a situation like that. Sometimes those kind of factories that are run, people get cue sheet credit and things like that. It's hard to tell them what to do. But even in film scoring, there are ethics. Of course, it shouldn't happen like that, where someone takes someone else's music credit for it. It's always happened, and it happens today, yeah. I see kids from SC that are in the film program and they come to see me for God knows what reason, but there are some very talented people that are doing it, and it gives you some kind of heart for the future of things. I don't know whether things are getting better and better with film music. I don't know whether it's better now than it was in the 60s. I don't think it is. I think maybe it's worse, but these kids are good. They're capable of doing it, you know? They're capable of doing animated pictures, which are difficult. Trevor, and the kind of stuff that David has often done, you know, action comedies, and that Trevor has done, they're enormously difficult to do, and that Michal has done. They're not noticed at Academy Award time and stuff like that, but they're the hardest picture to do. You can't fake it. You've got to be there, you know? You can't just hit a low D, as some composers often do, because that's what their samples do. They hit a low D and just hang on to it for a day and a half. You know? It doesn't work, you know, if people are cavorting around. You know?
Gentlemen, I want to thank you for being with us. This has been an absolute delight, and the love of what you do comes through. Clearly, you love being a part of this art form, despite its challenges, or maybe that is even part of the satisfaction in the fact that when you're working on a project, you're really able to make it all come together. So I want to thank you very much for being with us. It's been an absolute delight. Again, Michal Giacchino played a huge role in putting this together for us. We deeply appreciate it. Randy Newman, David Newman, and Trevor Rabin.
Good job.
I'm Larry Mantle. It's been great having you with us for a special edition of Air Talk from the Crawford Family Forum. Our thanks as well to Maria Giacchino and Dave Martina for all their help in producing the event. Also to Randy Newman's manager, Kathy Kerr, Trevor Rabin's manager, Laura Engel, and the Peter Smith Quartet, Peter Smith pianist we're hearing right now, Alan Mesquita, Edwin Livingston, Jake Reed, and to Steinway for providing our piano this evening. From all of us at Air Talk, have a terrific day. Thanks so much for joining us.